evening. This is Dr. Adel Bundok, Professor of Anatomy and Neuroscience, Mansoura University, Egypt. Today I will talk about the structure of the nervous system. I will give you just an introduction to the study of neuroanatomy, and then I will talk about the ventricular system of the brain and the cerebrospinal fluid. According to the structure of the nervous system is formed of two types of cells. Nerve cells, which are called the neurons, and they communicate by synapses or synapses. This is a nerve cell, okay? And this is the axon terminal, and this is the cell body and the nucleus of the nerve cell. The second type of cells is the supporting cells, which are called the neuroglia. We have four types of neuroglia. The first one, astrocytes, for support of the nerve cells. Second one, oligodendrocytes, for formation of the myelin in the central nervous system. The third type is microglia, which guard against inflammation or infection of the CNS. And the fourth type is the ependymal cells, which line the ventricles. I will talk about all of them later on. Start by the nerve cells. This is a nerve cell. The nerve cell is formed of cell body and the processes. The cell body is formed of nucleus and the cytoplasm, and the cytoplasm contains all the organelles, ribosomes, rough endoplasmic reticulum, and smooth endoplasmic reticulum, mitochondria, Golgi apparatus, neurofilaments, neurotubules, and also it contains inclusions. Okay, the process is one axon and dendrites. Okay, so the processes are one axon, and this axon transmits information from the nerve cell body to other nerve cell. And dendrites, and the function of the dendrites is to receive information from another nerve cells. So the nerve cell receives information via the dendrites and send information via the axon. Axons, these are axons, are like electric wires. They are either myelinated or unmyelinated. This is myelinated axon, and these are unmyelinated axons. The myelin is very important for insulation of the axons and for impulse conduction. And the thicker the myelin, the faster the conduction. Therefore, myelinated axons have fast conduction rate, and unmyelinated axons have low conduction rate. We have two types of myelin-producing cells. In the central nervous system, oligodendrocytes. In the brain and the spinal cord, oligodendrocytes. And in the peripheral nervous system, we have Schwann cells. This is axon, and this is Schwann cell wrapping the axon. Okay, so we have two types of cells which form myelin, oligodendrocytes in the CNS, and the Schwann cells in the peripheral nervous system. Okay, what are the types of the nerve cells? Nerve cells are divided according to their size, their function, and the number of processes into. Okay, according to size, we have large nerve cells, which are called Golgi type 1, and the small nerve cells, which are called Golgi type 2. So according to size, Golgi type 1 and Golgi type 2, Golgi type 1, large nerve cells, Golgi type 2, small nerve cells. The main difference is that the Golgi type 1 neurons have long axon, the Golgi type 2 neurons have short axons. According to function, we need nerve cell for movement. So we have motor neurons responsible for movement. We need nerve cells for perception of information, okay, or sensation. So we have sensory nerve cells for perception of sensations, and we need nerve cells to connect motor and sensory, or motor with motor, or sensory with sensory. So they are called interneurons. So according to function, we have three types of nerve cells: motor, sensory, and interneurons. According to the number of processes, we have three types. If nerve cells have only one process, they are called unipolar neuron. And unipolar neurons are of two types. True unipolar neurons, like this one, have only one process, and they are present in the retina, amacrine cells of the retina. And the other one is this one, pseudo unipolar nerve cells. These nerve cells have short process, which divides into two branches: central branch, which acts as axon, and the peripheral branch, which acts as dendrite. Okay, so unipolar neurons, either true or false or pseudo. Pseudo unipolar neurons are present in the sensory ganglia, like dorsal root ganglia and the cranial sensory ganglia. The other type is bipolar neurons. Bipolar neurons have only two processes, one axon and one dendrite, and they are present in the sense organs. They are present in the nose, present in the retina, present in the inner ear, okay, like spiral ganglion and cochlear ganglion of the cochlear nerve. And the third type, which is the commonest type, multipolar neuron, one axon and many dendrites, so more than two processes. According to the neuroglia, we have neuroglia in the central nervous system and the neuroglia in the peripheral nervous system. So we have central neuroglia and the peripheral neuroglia. Central neuroglia are four. Okay, the first one is astrocytes, star-shaped cells. These cells are very important. They support nerve cells. They transfer metabolites from blood vessels to the nerve cells. They store glycogen and transform the glycogen into glucose for the supply of the nerve cells. The second type is oligodendrocytes. This is an oligodendrocyte, myelin formation. Okay? And the third type is microglia. And they are responsible for guarding against inflammation, like macrophages. That's why microglia are derived from monocytes. And the fourth type is ependymal cells, and the ependymal cells line the ventricles, therefore they are involved in CSF production and CSF circulation. Peripheral neuroglia are two. This is the first one, Schwann cells, and again Schwann cells for production of myelin in the peripheral nerves. The second one, satellite cells, they surround the nerve cells of the dorsal root ganglia and autonomic ganglia, satellite cells. According to terminology, we have nucleus, like these nuclei, okay, nuclei in the brain, nuclei in the spinal cord. So nucleus is formed by collection of nerve cells inside the CNS, unlike ganglia, collection of nerve cells outside the CNS. Then we talk about synapses or synapses. What is meant by synapse and what are the types? Synapse is the contact point between two nerve cells, and they are divided into two according to the type of transmission. if transmission occurs by chemical substance, it is called the chemical synapse. So the first type is chemical synapse, transmission by chemical substance. If transmission occurs without chemical substance, it's called electrical synapse. So we have two types of synapses, chemical and electrical. Let us talk about the chemical synapse. The chemical synapse is formed of three elements. This is chemical synapse, and this is the synapse, the contact point between two nerve cells. So we have pre-synaptic element, synaptic cleft, and the post-synaptic element. The pre-synaptic element is always axon, and this axon terminal contains synaptic vesicles, mitochondria, and smooth endoplasmic reticulum. The post-synaptic element may be dendrite, may be axon, may be cell body, may be muscle. This is chemical synapse. How do you know that this is a chemical synapse? The presence of synaptic vesicles, which contain chemical substance called the neurotransmitter. So the chemical synapse, the three elements of the chemical synapse, presynaptic part, which is always axon, and this is axon terminal, contains synaptic vesicles, mitochondria, and the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Then synaptic cleft, and then postsynaptic element, which may be dendrite, may be axon, may be cell body, may be muscle. The presynaptic part contains synaptic vesicles, which are of two types. Clear vesicles and dense core vesicles like these ones. Clear vesicles usually contain acetylcholine. Dense core vesicles usually contain catecholamine, like norepinephrine. According to the two parts forming the synapse, chemical synapse or electrical synapse is divided into axodendritic, between axon and the dendrite. This one, axoaxonic, between axon and axon. And this one, axosomatic, between axon and the cell body, and the neuromuscular, between axon and the muscle. Again, this is axon, this is dendrite, axon dendrite, so this synapse is axodendritic. This one, axon and axon, so it is axoaxonic. This one between axon and the cell body, axosomatic. And this one between axon and the muscle, it is neuromuscular. Just reminding you of the divisions of the nervous system. We have central nervous system, formed of the brain and the spinal cord. We have peripheral nervous system, divided into somatic part and autonomic part. So somatic nervous system and the autonomic nervous system. Somatic nervous system formed by spinal nerves arising from the spinal cord, 31 pairs. Cranial nerves arising from the brain, 12 pairs, and associated ganglia, spinal ganglia, and cranial ganglia. Autonomic nervous system part arise from the thoracolumbar part of the spinal cord, thoracolumbar or sympathetic. And the other part arises from the brain and the sacral region of the spinal cord, craniosacral or parasympathetic. Again, nervous system is divided into central nervous system, peripheral somatic, and the peripheral autonomic. Central nervous system formed of brain, spinal cord, peripheral somatic, formed of spinal nervous 31 pairs, cranial nervous 12 pairs, and the spinal and cranial ganglia. Peripheral autonomic, sympathetic or sacrolumbar part, parasympathetic or craniosacral part. This is our brain. It is divided into four brain, midbrain, and hindbrain. The four brain is formed of cerebral hemisphere and the diencephalon, and the diencephalon is formed of thalamus, hypothalamus, hypothalamus, and the subthalamus. Then midbrain, and the cavity of the midbrain is the aqueduct of Sylvius. Then hindbrain, formed of pons, medulla, and the cerebellum, and the cavity of the hindbrain is the fourth ventricle. Again, another brain division. The brain is divided into cerebrum, and the cerebrum is the forebrain, formed of cerebral hemisphere and the diencephalon. Second part is cerebellum, and the third part is this midline structure, brainstem. And the brainstem, formed of midbrain, pons, and the medulla. Again, this is our brain, formed of cerebrum, cerebellum, brainstem. The cerebrum is formed of cerebral hemispheres, diencephalon, and the diencephalon formed of thalamus, hypothalamus, epithalamus, and subthalamus. The thalamus is a sensory relay station. It has many functions. We'll talk about them later on. The hypothalamus is the principal autonomic and endocrine center. The epithalamus contains the pineal gland, which secretes melatonin or hormone of darkness. So cerebrum and the cerebellum and the brainstem. And the brainstem, midbrain, pons, and the medulla. The ventricular system is formed of lateral ventricle in the cerebral hemisphere, third ventricle in the diencephalon. The two communicates by foramen of Monroe. Then fourth ventricle in the hindbrain, and the fourth ventricle communicates with the third ventricle by aqueduct of Sylvius. This is the brainstem, formed of three structures from above downward, midbrain, pons, and medulla oblongata. This is a section of the spinal cord, formed of white matter and gray matter. The white matter is white because it is formed of myelinated axons. The gray matter is gray because it is formed of cell bodies. The gray matter is divided into three horns: dorsal horn, sensory; ventral horn, motor; and lateral horn, autonomic. And this lateral horn is present only in the thoracic region and the upper two segment and the upper two lumbar segments of the spinal cord. That's why this part is part of the thoracic region of the spinal cord. So we finished with the divisions of the nervous system. Now let us talk about the peripheral nervous system briefly. Peripheral nervous system consists of a spinal nerves, 31 pairs, cranial nerves, 12 pairs, and the spinal and the cranial ganglia, which are sensory ganglia. This is the spinal nerve. This one. And this spinal nerve is formed of two roots. Dorsal root, which is sensory. Ventral root, which is motor. The dorsal root has a swelling formed by the dorsal root ganglion. This is the dorsal root ganglion. This is the dorsal horn, which is sensory. This is the ventral horn, which is motor. This is the dorsal root, which is sensory. This is the ventral root, which is motor. This is the spinal nerve, which is mixed, formed of sensory and motor fibers. Again, this is the spinal nerve or peripheral nerve, formed of dorsal root and the ventral root. The dorsal root is sensory. The ventral root is motor. The dorsal root contains the dorsal root ganglion. And remember that the nerve cells in the dorsal root ganglion are pseudo unipolar nerve cells. Just the clinical aspect of the spinal nerve. As I said, the dorsal root is sensory, the ventral root is motor, and the spinal nerve itself contains motor and sensory fibers. Therefore, lesion in the dorsal root causes loss of sensation. Lesion in the ventral root causes motor paralysis. Lesion in the spinal nerve causes motor paralysis and sensory loss. Now we talk about the ventricular system and the cerebrospinal fluid. The brain ventricles start by the two ventricles in the two cerebral hemispheres, lateral ventricles, one in each cerebral hemisphere. The third ventricle in the diencephalon. Then fourth ventricle in the hind brain, the lateral ventricle and the third ventricle communicates by foramen of Monroe, and the third ventricle and the fourth ventricle communicates by cerebral aqueduct of Sylvius. Again, these are the two cerebral hemispheres, and these are the two lateral ventricles. Number two is the third ventricle, and number three is the fourth ventricle. You see these two foramina connect the lateral ventricle with the third ventricle, and this duct number four is the cerebral aqueduct, connects the third ventricle with the fourth ventricle, and the fourth ventricle has three foramina, foramina of Luschka and the foramen of Magendie. Again, this is the lateral ventricle, third ventricle, and the fourth ventricle. This is foramen of Monroe. This is aqueduct of Sylvius. Notice that the ventricular system contains this red structure, which is the choroid plexus. The choroid plexus is present in lateral ventricle, foramen of Monroe, third ventricle, and the fourth ventricle. And these choroid plexuses are very important for production of cerebrospinal fluid. Which part of the ventricular system doesn't contain choroid plexus? It is the cerebral aqueduct of Sylvius. And actually, the choroid plexus of the lateral ventricle is continuous with the choroid plexus of the third ventricle through or at the foramen of Monroe. Now let us talk about the cerebrospinal fluid. Cerebrospinal fluid is a fluid. Where is it? It fills the ventricular system and the subarachnoid space. Most of the cerebrospinal fluid is present in the subarachnoid space, not the ventricle. Okay? So the cerebrospinal fluid is present mainly in the subarachnoid space. It is also present in the ventricular system. How much is the volume of the cerebrospinal fluid? It is 130 milliliters. 30 milliliters in the ventricular system and 100 milliliters in the subarachnoid space. So most of the amount of the cerebrospinal fluid is present in the subarachnoid space. Then we'll talk about production of cerebrospinal fluid. It is produced mainly by the choroid plexuses in the lateral ventricle, in the third ventricle, in the fourth ventricle. 70% of the cerebrospinal fluid produced by the choroid plexus. Then let's talk about circulation. From the lateral ventricle to the third ventricle through foramen of Monroe, where the amount of cerebrospinal fluid is increased. Increased by the choroid plexus of the third ventricle. From the third ventricle to the fourth ventricle through the aqueduct of Sylvius, where the amount is increased in the fourth ventricle by the choroid plexus in the fourth ventricle. Then a small amount of cerebrospinal fluid enters the central canal of the spinal cord, and most of the amount pass through the foramina of the fourth ventricle to the subarachnoid space, where it is drained by arachnoid villi and granulations in the dural venous sinuses, mainly the superior sagittal sinus. So drainage of CSF mainly by arachnoid villi and granulations in the dural venous sinuses, okay, mainly the superior sagittal sinus. Therefore, the cerebrospinal fluid is finally drained into the venous blood. Arachnoid granulations have one-way valve. They permit the passage of cerebrospinal fluid from the subarachnoid space to the venous blood. Then we'll talk about the function of the cerebrospinal fluid. Again, let us talk about circulation of the cerebrospinal fluid. We'll start by lateral ventricle, then foramen of Monroe, then the third ventricle, where the amount is increased, then aqueduct of Sylvius, then fourth ventricle, where the amount is increased, small amount enters the central canal, and most of the amount of the CSF pass through the foramina, the three foramina of the fourth ventricle to the subarachnoid space, foramen of Magendie and the foramina of Loschka. And then in the subarachnoid space, goes around the brain and the spinal cord, and finally drained by arachnoid villi and the granulations to the venous blood in the dural venous sinuses, mainly the superior sagittal sinus. What moves the cerebrospinal fluid in the subarachnoid space and in the ventricular system? Three factors are responsible for movement of the cerebrospinal fluid. Number one, the cilia of the ependymal cells. Number two, the pulsation of the cerebral arteries in the subarachnoid space. And number three, the pressure gradient between drainage and production. What are the functions of the cerebrospinal fluid? The weight of the brain is 1400 grams, and actually we don't feel 1400 grams in our head. We only feel about 25 grams. So cerebrospinal fluid, the brain actually floats on the cerebrospinal fluid. So cerebrospinal fluid reduces the brain weight 60 folds from 1400 grams to 25 grams. Fluid around the brain protection. Actually, cerebrospinal fluid replaces the lymphatic system in the CNS. So cerebrospinal fluid transfers waste products from the CSF to the blood. It maintains chemical environment through communication with the brain extracellular space and regulation of the intracranial pressure. Then we'll talk about clinical aspect of the cerebrospinal fluid. I will talk about three cases. The first one is hydrocephalus. Second one is lumbar puncture, inserting a needle into the subarachnoid space. And the third one, papilledema or edema around the optic disc. This is the retina. So we'll start by hydrocephalus. What is hydrocephalus? Hydrocephalus is increased volume of the cerebrospinal fluid, which causes dilatation of the ventricles, which causes enlargement of the head. So the sequence of events: increased volume of CSF, dilatation of the ventricles, increased size of the head. What are the three causes of hydrocephalus? Logically, the first cause is increased production by tumor of the choroid plexus, and it is rare. The second cause is obstruction to its circulation, and this is the commonest cause. Obstruction to circulation in any part of the ventricular system, but usually at the narrowest parts, like foramen of Monroe, foramen of Lushka, foramen of Magendie. But the commonest site of obstruction is the aqueduct of Sylvius. Okay. And the third cause is defective drainage. There is no drainage of CSF due to thrombosis of the dural venous sinuses or thrombosis of the superior sagittal sinus. So we have three causes of hydrocephalus: increased production, obstruction to circulation, and the defective drainage. These are cases of hydrocephalus. This is MRI of hydrocephalus. This is normal brain. This is the lateral ventricle, the posterior horn. This is the lateral ventricle, the anterior horn. And this is the third ventricle. You see here, dilated lateral ventricles. And then we'll talk about the lumbar puncture. Lumbar puncture is insertion of a needle, inserting a needle into the subarachnoid space. Why we do lumbar puncture? Three reasons. This is a needle in the subarachnoid space. Okay. Usually we insert the needle between L4 and L3 and L4. Or between L4 and L5, but usually between L3 and L4. Three main reasons. Number one, to take sample of CSF for analysis. If we find the blood in the sample, it means cerebral hemorrhage. If you find the pus in the cerebrospinal fluid, it means meningitis. Also, we use lumbar puncture to inject drugs like anesthetics and antibiotics, spinal anesthesia. And also we can insert a manometer to the syringe to measure the CSF pressure. And the CSF pressure is 130 millimeter mercury. It's exactly like the volume of the cerebrospinal fluid. The third case is papilledema, or edema around the optic disc. The optic nerve is surrounded by meninges. surrounded by pia, arachnoid, and dura. So the optic nerve is surrounded by cerebrospinal fluid. Increased cerebrospinal fluid will compress the optic nerve and causes papilledema. So increased intracranial pressure around the optic nerve causes papilledema, and it may cause blindness. And thank you very much. Good luck and the best wishes.